Welcome to this series of videos on accessibility requirements for public procurement of ICT products and services in Europe, the EN301549 standard. This is video number 10. It's sponsored by Microsoft and produced by Funke. My name is Susanna Lorin. I'm an accessibility expert with a long experience in standardization. In this video, we are going to take a closer look at Chapter 10 of the EN standard, which covers non-web documents. Chapter 10 is based on Web Content Accessibility Guidelines 2.0, or WCAG, which are referred to in Chapter 9 on Web. In the two previous videos, we are describing WCAG more in detail. If you haven't seen those videos, you should do that first. But if you already know WCAG and what the success criteria cover, then you can continue watching this video. So, what does non-web documents mean? In this context, non-web documents refers to digital documents that are not web pages. This could, for example, be text documents, spreadsheets, or presentations. Whether you publish the documents on a web page or not is not relevant for this distinction. Non-web documents only refers to documents that are not web pages, are not embedded in a web page, and documents that might be embedded in a web page but are not rendered together with a web page. If you have a link to a document, that document is not rendered together with a web page. Therefore, this chapter in the standard is relevant to that document. But it is also relevant to documents that are not published on the internet at all, like user manuals, newsletters, and so on. The first subsection in this chapter is an informative general section that defines the scope of the chapter. It does not contain any requirements in itself. The second subsection covers the success criteria that are relevant for non-web documents. 10.2 Document Success Criteria. This is a large subsection. There are references to all success criteria in WCAG. Some of them do not apply to non-web documents and therefore do not contain any requirements, but many of the success criteria in WCAG are relevant to non-web documents as well. For each of those success criterion, there is a short text with comments on the differences on how to use the criterion when it comes to non-web documents in comparison to web pages. There are two criteria in Chapter 10 that are not directly based on WCAG. In this video, we are not going to go into detail to all those success criteria. We are only going to comment on those that differ from Chapter 9 when it comes to non-web documents. To make the numbering of requirements in the EN301549 consistent with WCAG 2.0, the EN standard contains empty clauses where there is a success criterion for something in Chapter 9 that is not relevant to non-web documents. The empty clauses are 10.2.20 bypass blocks, which is based on WCAG 2.0, success criterion 2.4.1 bypass blocks. 10.2.24 multiple ways, which is based on WCAG 2.0, success criterion 2.4.5 multiple ways. 10.2.31 consistent navigation, which is based on WCAG 2.0, success criterion 3.2.3 consistent navigation, and 10.2.32 consistent identification, which is based on WCAG 2.0, success criterion 3.2.4 consistent identification. There are a set of requirements that focus on audio and video. The parts 9.2.2 to 9.2.6 are also relevant when it comes to non-web documents. So the same requirements that are relevant for web pages also applies to non-web documents where you might have audio and/or video content. One comment is worth mentioning here. If you do have audio-only or video-only content in your document and you provide an alternative, you can do that in the same document or in another document, but it needs to be clear for the user where to find the alternative version. 10.2.13 Resize Text is worth mentioning from a non-web document perspective. It is based on WCAG 2.0, success criterion 1.4.4, Resize Text. This requirement is intended to make sure that users can zoom text at least 200%. This can be done in different ways. Many document formats have software players that make it possible to do this, so the ability to zoom is not in the document itself, but rather in the software. You need to make sure that users are able to zoom the content. This means that you need to use a format that supports this and create it in a way that works well when zoomed. It is not enough to use a format that is possible to zoom. If the users cannot view the document in a software player that allows them to zoom it, you must make sure that the whole chain works. 10.2.21, document titled, is based on WCAG 2.0, Success Criterion 2.4.2, page titled. The document must have a title that describes the topic or purpose of the document. The name of the document might be a good title if the name describes what the document is all about. 10.2.28, Language of Parts, is based on WCAG 2.0, Success Criterion 3.1.2, Language of Parts. When a document contains text in more than one language, the part of the document that is written in another language than the main one has to be defined as well. When it comes to non-web documents, there are some document formats where there up to this date is no method of indicating changes in the language that is supported by assistive technology. With those formats, it is not possible to meet this success criterion. Therefore, you must make sure that the format you are using can provide accessibility to all users. 10.2.29 on focus is based on WCAG 2.0, Success Criterion 3.2.1 on focus. It is equally important to meet the requirement on focus in non-web documents as it is on a web page. But there is a note here. If a document consists of parts with different functionality, for example a presentation with an embedded spreadsheet, the view as well as the way to interact with the content may change when navigating between the different parts. This is not a problem and should not be considered a failure to meet this success criterion, because the change was not caused by a change of focus. 10.2.37, Parsing, is based on WCAG 2.0, Success Criterion 4.1.1, Parsing. For documents that use markup languages that are presented to and supported by assistive technology, this requirement is relevant. The same four basic rules as for web pages apply here. The code should be correct. If you need to make exceptions, it is important that the code at least follows these four rules. It has complete start and end tags, it is nested according to the specifications, it does not contain duplicate attributes, and any ID values are unique. The requirement 10.2.39, caption positioning, is not directly based on WCAG 2.0. This requirement states that if the document contains synchronized media with captions, the captions should not obscure relevant information in the synchronized media. 10.2.40, Audio Description Timing, is not directly based on WCAG 2.0. If the document contains synchronized media with audio description, the audio description should not interfere with relevant audio information in the synchronized media. These are the requirements that differ between web content covered in Chapter 9 and non-web documents covered in Chapter 10. As you can see, most of the requirements are the same. With that said, the way to meet the requirements can differ quite a lot between a web page and a non-web document. Depending on what type of non-web document you are working with, virtually all success criteria in WCAG could potentially be relevant. If you are creating, for example, a dynamic document with forms, menus, input fields, and error messages, the document is practically a web page. In this situation, you should try to meet all success criteria in WCAG. However, for most of us, non-web documents are much simpler than this. If you are working with a standard text document, for example, there are only a few success criteria that are relevant. These success criteria are usually the ones to focus on when you work with non-web documents. 10.2.1, non-text content. 10.2.7, info and relationships. 10.2.9, sensory characteristics. 10.2.10, use of color. 10.2.12, contrast minimum. 10.2.14, images of text. 10.2.18, pause, stop, hide. 10.2.21, document titled. 10.2.23, link purpose in context. 10.2.25, headings and labels. And 10.2.27, language of document. Remember, documents are important. There are differences between how well assistive technology can handle different document formats. So even if there is a way of meeting a requirement in a specific document format, you need to make sure that there are software and assistive technology that support these accessibility features. If you would like to know more, please have a look at our other videos. There is one video for each chapter in the standard. Thanks for watching!